That's the run. Nabi Ali Salam is the greatest creation of Allah. How is great over every creation. This is how an alim is greater than the speaker of the sea. This is how an alim, a scholar, a man of knowledge, ilm, he is better than the person who just worships. See, there's this constant argument about worshiping and knowledge. Knowledge and worship together, but it's a deadly compound. This is what Bishr Hafi was. Sayyidina Bishr al-Hafi, he left everything and he left the path of seeking knowledge and spreading the deen, and he went and absorbed himself into worship of Allah. So he knew who he was worshipping. He said, this is why Sayyidina Bishr used to say, you will not find the sweetness of worship until between you and your Lord there is an iron wall. لا تجد حلاوة العبادة حتى بينك وبين الله تعالى صدى وكما قال. You won't find the sweetness of ibadah, okay? Between you and Allah there is an iron wall. A man of Allah can only say this. A man who knows of Allah can only say between the desire of you and between, no, actually between you and your desire. Not between you and Allah, between you and your desire there is an iron wall. Until then, that's when you will be able to connect with Allah. But if you are worshipping Allah and your desires are whispering to you, talking to you, the shaitan talks to you, your ego talks to you, then how much of you are you going to think of Allah and how much are you going to think of your bed? Tell me. How much are you going to think of Allah Almighty? How much are you going to think, you know what, I'm going to get out of here, ASAP. ASAP, the man's taking too long. He ain't really quick enough. That's what happens, isn't it? This is when your ego ain't trained, when you don't have knowledge. Or if you have knowledge and it's weak. And it's not just about knowledge that you have knowledge. You have to continue and fail this by becoming somebody who learns and acts. Somebody who trains himself. Right now, each and every one of you should seek knowledge. You should learn about your religion. You should learn and be able to give answers, basic answers. Basics of your religion. How do you stand? How do you sit? Islam teaches us this. What's the etiquette? These are very important things that each and every one of us need to learn. Do you know what Sayyidina Sheikh Abdul Qadir Jilani radiallahu anhu used to say in his Al-Qasidatul Ghawsiyya? Qasidatul Ghawsiyya is a very famous poem that Shaykh Abdul Qadir Jilani radiallahu anhu wrote. In there, he has a couplet that he mentions. I will quote it to you. He said, "Darastu al-ilma hatta sirtu qutban." Shaykh Abdul Qadir Jilani used to say, "Darastu al-ilma." I learned knowledge, I seek knowledge, I sought knowledge. Hatta sirtu qutban, until I became qutbul aqtar, I became the greatest wali of my time. But to become the greatest wali of my time, what did I have to do? I had to seek knowledge. This is what Shaykh Abdul Qadir Jilani said. He said, to become a man of Allah, you have to have knowledge. Some of the greatest awliya of Allah were the greatest ulama. Imam Ghazali, everyone knows who Imam Al-Ghazali is. You know Imam Ghazali? Arguably, one of the most learned men, not of his kind, but in the Ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One of the most learned men in the Ummah, the entire Ummah. He was bestowed with the title of Hujjat al-Islam. He was known as the proof of Islam. For every question he had an answer. And because he went deep into philosophy and all these things, he realized his knowledge was going and asking question upon question. And you know what he was advised to do when he got to this stage? They said to him, go sit with the Sufiya. Go sit with the men of Allah. If you want to know who Allah is, he went to that point that he was questioning, who is Allah? He had so much knowledge, he was going, who is Allah? And he said, where can I find Allah? Where is that question going to be answered? And the people advised him, his peers, His brother advised him what? They said, go sit with the men of Allah, awliya Allah, they will tell you who is Allah. The men who have knowledge of Allah, the ma'rifah, the ma'rifah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, will sit with them and then they. And it's narrated that Sayyidina Imam Ghazali, for 14 years, he sat with the awliya Allah. And you know what he did? He left everything. He took off his best clothes, he took off old ragged clothes, jubba. And he would take and carry his books one day. His books, they had been thrown into the water, they had been stolen. And he became very sad. And it was said to him that you should have so much knowledge, you should know your books so well, that you should know them by heart. Even if it was taken away from you, you would know what you know. You will not forget it. What's in your mind, you can't forget. And this Imam Ghazali, after the path of tariqat and suluk, after this path of going out and seeking and having ma'rifat of Allah Almighty, Hujjat of Islam, Imam Abu Muhammad Al-Ghazali, he wrote the great book, Ihya Ulumuddin, Revival of the Sciences of the Religion, Revival of the Sciences of the Deen. This is a book that is taught throughout the entire world. Imam Nawawi used to say, Imam Nawawi was one of the biggest muhaddis of his time. He used to say that if the Quran hadn't been revealed, then this book of Imam Ghazali would guide man until the day of Qiyamah. That's how much guidance you find in this book. And Imam Ghazali, a man of knowledge, such a powerful man of knowledge, that on the day that he was going to die, the night before, he said to his family, dig my grave. Tomorrow I will die after Fajr, prepare my coffin. They read the Fajr, they prepared the coffin, washed their body, and they were waiting for the angel of death to come and take their life. To get to that stage, brother, you have got to seek knowledge. You can't become the greatest Allama and scholar by going to Sheikh Google and say, Sheikh Saab, give me fatwa, Mufti. Free fatwa. Google gives them the answer. Where you seek your knowledge from, that's a very important thing. You can't take your knowledge from any Tom, Dick, and Harry. Just because he's got a beard doesn't mean he has knowledge, brother. I'll bring people who don't have beards have more knowledge than men who have beard. It ain't about how big your beard is that the guy might have knowledge. This is just one aspect of your religion, the appearance. That's another thing. We'll talk on another occasion. Knowledge isn't defined by the way a person looks. Don't be deceived by somebody because he looks like a scholar that he must be a scholar. Because that's a deception. I have a lot of young lads who come on the deen and they think the guy's got beard, he's wearing the jubba, he's got chadri here, he's got a walking stick, and the guy must be a Sufi, he might be a man of Allah. Then he's got a big title. This means I will ask him a question about the deen. Brother, when he goes to him and he says, brother, I don't even know the answer. I didn't even know the answer. MashaAllah, I'm not talking the dress, you dress like that. But some ulama, they know what they used to say. They said, don't dress like a scholar if you're not a scholar. Why? Because you might be a deception to the people. People might think you're a scholar and you're not even a scholar. So it's very important. All these things have to be read and taken into mind. To see, you know, a alim, he will never say he's an alim. A true scholar will never say, I'm an alim. Brother, what are you? I'm an alim. You know, I'm a scholar. The guy who says he's an alim, Nabir Islam said, he's a jahil. He's an ignorant man. A true man of Allah will never say he's a man of Allah, knowledge. Why? Because what does knowledge do? If knowledge makes you arrogant, brother, there's a big problem. That's making you shaitan. His knowledge made him arrogant. But if the knowledge is humbling you, then you're a man. Knowledge should humble you, should make you more humble. This is the reality. Knowledge should make you humble in your nature, in a person that you are. And knowledge instills fear of Allah inside you. إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءُ It's the scholars who fear Allah Almighty from His servants. Why? Because they know this is the state, this is how it is. So it's very important that we seek knowledge. We learn about our religion. Do not, they say ignorance is bliss. And an idle mind is the devil's playground. We like to live idly and we like to live in ignorance. Brother, I don't know, I will be punished. I don't know, God ain't gonna ask me. Brother, you saying, I don't know, God ain't gonna ask me, God's gonna ask you about that. Allah's gonna say, you need to say this. Why? That means you didn't wanna learn. You didn't wanna seek knowledge. So you should go up and giving everyone this nekiki dawah, I'm giving everyone an invitation to this good. Not that we become scholars, but that at least know when you have to put your nails. At least know how to read namaz in janazah. How do you read namaz? Every year people get confused because they go only twice a year. Do I raise my hand six times? What do I do? You know what people do? They go, Allahu Akbar. That's what they do. They look extra. You know, I make a mistake, bro. Wait, I make a mistake. I don't bother you do it. Meditation. You are not. You are cool. What do I do? Brother, if you knew, then you wouldn't have to look at it. Great is namaz, eh? You're connecting on the day of happiness with Allah Almighty when you look at Baba next to you.
Very important.
Mean namaz. Basics in it. Jum'ah. What are the conditions of Jum'ah? Listen to the khutbah. Being there, present, on time. People go in second and Jum'ah by Jum'ah. Aha, I didn't want it. Probably didn't even listen to the khutbah. Khutbah is part of the Jum'ah. These are very important things. How do we know? If you're going to travel, how much do you have to travel? Do we consider it travel if you shorten your prayer? What if you travel the entire world and you don't make intention to travel? Are you a traveler? Will you be considered? Abu Hanifa Rahmatullah says, if you travel the entire world and you haven't made intention to travel, you still read full salat every way you go. It's only when you make niyyah that you are considered a traveler. That's a condition of traveling. Look, women, even though I don't think there's any sisters here, rulings of hayd and nifas, the menstrual cycle, what's the ruling on that? What can a woman do? If you're impure, majorly impure, you've had a wet dream, or you've had sexual intercourse, or you've experienced this, are you allowed to preach the Quran? Are you allowed to read the Quran? Are you allowed to enter the masjid? What's the ruling? Common sense says no, obviously. But what if to get to your house you have to go to the mosque? What do you do? There's no wudu, you can't have a ghusl. In that circumstance, the ulama say you make tayammum. You walk to the mosque and when you get home, you make a ghusl. How many people do that? I'm not saying that, you know, a prize here, your house is there, you have to go to the Harun mosque. No, it's just rulings, isn't it? These rulings everyone needs to know. What every Muslim needs to know, very important. This is in relation to fiqh. With fiqh, there's always going to be that ikhtilaf. You know, in relation to aqeedah, for example, the basic question of everyone, you know, you find people, is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam like me and you? Really? Just comprehending the question like that, that question posed to you, that the Prophet is like me and you, that tells you of these people's faith. So, if you say he's not like me and you, then you always get that one person who says, bro, tell me why. You know, the why mentality comes from going to university and questioning, why, bro? Why is it this? People just keep saying, why? They don't listen, they just want to say, why? So why? You say the Prophet's not like me and you, why? Tell me. They'll go verse to you, bro, what are you going to respond? They'll say, that Allah says, that I am a human like me, like you. The Prophet is told to say, I am human like you. Were you going to respond to counter that? Do you have enough knowledge to counter that? Because I know a lot of young people who have gone to university, that question has been posed. Why did you cut them? Why did you cut them on the 14th day, fourth day? They will say, bro, innovation, not allowed. prove as we believe. We're going to serve on the 14th Khatr, 4th day Khatr. Somebody says you do Milad, you celebrate the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You commemorate, you remember it. Bro, the Prophet never did this. Proof. Show me what had this. The Prophet Islam did this. When you going to say? And when he shows you, you're going to feel disheartened. And what ends up happening when you get disheartened, then they pounce on you, bro. They get you. They say, brother, I'll tell you, come here. I'll give you the knowledge. Then they brainwash you, and before you know it, you're somebody who leads the Prophet's life behind you. But why did they get to that stage? Because you didn't go. You need to know these things. All these things. These matters about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's rank, who Allah Almighty is, the do's and don'ts of your religion. Very important. May Allah give us tawfiq to act upon what I say. Inshallah, Allah, next week I will continue with this topic about seeking knowledge, importance of knowledge, and how we should go about doing. Allah give us tawfiq to become amongst the knowledgeable people and grant us knowledge that is going to give us benefit and that will help us in this world, and that most definitely that will help us, and inshallah, is knowledge that is going to help us in the next world. Give us ma'rifat of Allah Almighty. أقول قولي هذا أستغفر الله لي ولكم وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين. Just before Suhoor, just to mention to everyone that I started to produce, but I am producing myself CDs of my lectures and talks. This is a lecture and talk that I did under a year ago, about 10-11 months ago, in Halifax on drugs and alcohol. The realities of drugs and alcohol is about 1 hour, 40-45 minute talk. It's a very relevant of today to the youth talk. There's a lot of jokes in it, a lot of interaction, and a lot of maybe inspiration that you can gain from it. These are CDs that are £3 per CD. Anybody who is interested in this, buying this CD, this is the first CD that we are making. Inshallah, we will be putting vast amount of investment and hopefully, inshallah, more stuff into making these CDs on different various subjects and topics that I've done. I record most likely from all of my talks, so they will go on to CD and you can play it in your cars. If none of you, which I know that there's no drug dealers here, I don't know if it will be relevant to you. I know brothers who have heard this talk and they're not drug dealers but they enjoy it. If you know people who are drug dealers or anything like that and you feel you benefit to them, you buy it and give it as sadaqa to them. It's charity for you. If he becomes better through listening to this, you will get more reward than I will. Why? Because you are the one who gave me. You were the one who opened the door to him. I was the only one who was talking on what was my talking to do. And you will get the reward. So it's an investment for yourself in the next world. Invest into this, buy it, and give it out to the brothers, sisters, whatever you feel that is good for you. And inshallah, hopefully all the proceeds will go into making the next CD that I intend to release and publish and get out, inshallah. So please, if you are interested, at the back there will be a little bit of consent at the end, inshallah. Inshallah, we make dua and we can continue. I don't know when the send is going to arrive.
About 20 minutes.
I think it's good that because time is going back now, Sahi, you know, as soon as I finish, Sahi do an hour's talk, do suhoor, then they can go home and close their fast. Anyway, push it deep then. Platforms, just, you know, for future reference.
15 minutes.
Need to get the car back to the brother who bought it. I'm going to have to get out. The rest of you can stick around. You know, I don't know if Hans has got anything planned. One of them there, the YouTuber, what's his name?
Hamza.
Brother Hamza, mashallah, very active, very loud, very happy. He's very productive. He'll give you better advice than I do. He has got more experience than I have in life. So maybe I'll hand over to him. I make dua, inshallah, and we'll take it from there.
اللهم صل على سيدنا مولانا محمد معدن الجود والكرم وعلى اله وصحبه اجمعين. ربنا اتنا في الدنيا حسنه وفي الاخره حسنه وقنا عذاب النار. ربنا تقبل منا انك انت السميع العليم. تب علينا انك انت التواب الرحيم. ربنا افرغ علينا صبرا وثبت اقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. اللهم اغفر لجميع المؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات الاحياء منهم والاموات. اللهم يا شافي الامراض اشف امراضنا واشف سائر المسلمين وافوض امورنا الى الله ان الله بصير بالعباد. اللهم انك عفو كريم تحب العفو فاعف عنا يا عفو يا كريم. اللهم ارزقنا شهادة في سبيلك واجعل موتنا في بلد رسولك. اللهم اجعل accept our presence in the Barra. اللهم اجعل accept all the good that you have done today. اللهم اجعل forgive us for our major and minor sins. Those who are ill, give them shifa and calming. Those who are struggling throughout the world, Allah Almighty, give them your Rabbana Madad. Those who have been killed in Burma and in Syria and in these countries throughout the world, who have been tortured and butchered, and Allah Almighty, who have been zulm that has been done upon them, Allah Almighty, as you can see of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the Firdaus, give them all subject to me. Increase in our knowledge, give us knowledge that will give us benefit in this world and the next. Allahumma fa'na bima allamtana wa 'allimna ma yanfa'una. وزدنا علما وزدنا علما وزدنا حكما والحمد لله على كل حال. صلى الله تعالى على خير خلقه سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى اله وصحبه اجمعين برحمتك يا ارحم الراحمين.